Hello, ladies and gentlemen. Thank you to Red Pill Gamers. Today I have with me Dean Esme and Mad Cat, and we'll be talking about the Fallout 3 and 4, 3 in New Vegas specifically, with a Red Pill perspective. And the Fallout series has been a long-running series that was revitalized in roughly 08 with Fallout 3, and it was one of those games that caught me, and I think for a lot of people who are within the Red Pill, did actually a lot of good things, pointing out a lot of masculine and positive masculine virtues. One of the first ones was your introduction to the Fallout universe with your father, and how he was doing everything to protect you and save you and help you, and that kind of story builds from there about the strength and importance of fatherhood, and you do see that growing bit by bit. And this was a game that was a very solid RPG that many, many people loved, and it has grown and re-brought back the Fallout series. And later this year, we will be having Fallout 4, and I'm going to leave it to the floor to discuss Fallout now as a whole, but just giving everyone the generic idea of what it is about them. Guys?
Well, it's interesting that you brought up, because when I first played Fallout 3, I was one of those who came on Fallout 3. I respect the earlier canon, but you know, those aren't games I played, and so Fallout 3 is where I started. I was in not a great place in my life when that happened, too, and so when I fell into it, it really felt like I was going into another reality, which was a good fit for me at that point. That was a kind of low point in my life. But regardless, even, you know, I mean, this is the thing for people. The point is that this is something you can immerse yourself in, and as you want, or as deep you want, as you want, in terms of investing in exploring the story versus just running around and killing things and meeting base objectives, the richness of the experience came in from the fact that it is a true sandbox. It's about anything within a very large world, and so it really feels like every gameplay experience you have is unique. But I never keyed on the fact until I think when I replayed Fallout 3 recently. And then go on New Vegas again. To kind of warm up and remember. And I was amazed at how much I still enjoyed and totally really did feel like I was repeating myself that much, because the playthrough was so different. Even though I tend to do certain things the same way, the fact is that this is a game where the butterfly effect appears, and you have a wildly different experience every time you play. And but you're right that the main storyline is
between father and child. Dean, I don't know if you know, but you're breaking up just a bit.
I'm sorry to hear it. I was all very long, but you sort of started to talk about it from a real thing. That storyline in Fallout 3 is a very important story about a father's relationship to a child. I suppose it must be something of a tragedy if you run your character as an evil character, but it doesn't change the relationship with the father. Yeah. That's a great motif. And otherwise, what I notice about the game series is that as a character, there is no sex to be found in Fallout. If anything, the sex is unrealistic toward making females a little too powerful, right? In terms of physical strength. But other than that, the game is whatever you want it to be, right? You would think that it would be held up by the, you think it'd be held up by feminists as a great video game, wouldn't you, if any of them play video games? Because here's one of the biggest franchises of the last decade, and just are no gender roles to be found in anything, no assigned gender roles anyway, right? There's not there.
I kind of disagree with you on that.
Okay, tell me how. Well, as per usual for all video games and entertainment, males get killed at like 10-to-1 ratio.
Well, yeah, other than that. I mean, technically, in this game, men and women can be killed equally. There's nothing in the game that says that killing them is bad, although you can get perks that are gendered, such as a Black Widow perk or Lady Killer, which gives you bonus points to killing the opposite gender than what you are. But there are instances taking on gender roles, such as, you know, the father is the person who's doing all the work to bring, you know, whatever resource back home, and women are basically there to raise the children. However, I would agree partially with you that we don't see this a whole lot in the game, but it is still in there.
Oh, of course, it is. But I just meant in terms of what you want to do with your character and the, you know, I think in the entire Fallout series, they put one thing you could call sexist in there, where if you were a female character, you couldn't do certain things. But even then, they would find ways to find something where you had to be female to do certain things. So it's, I mean, and none of those are big things, right? They aren't game changer.
Mm-hmm.
I'm just saying you would think that they would be being upheld by these people who claim they are, oh, what about equality and all that? Well, Fallout Universe
actually
is tough, but
feminists don't like these games in the fact that you're not definitively male or female. You can choose what gender you are, and
oh,
they treat it as just being nothing but a male character.
Oh,
so they
fine.
Don't like these particular
right.
kinds of games.
You're right. They can never be pleased. Never mind. Sorry I said anything.
But you're right, though. They should uphold this game for that reason, that it's men, because they're always saying that, you know, men and women are basically the exact same, and any differences that you might perceive, whether they're natural, biological, are all just social constructs. So these games would actually personify that exact idea that men and women are the exact same. And yet they don't like these games for that exact reason.
You would think, because, I mean, honestly, you could choose to be a female character and gameplay is virtually identical with very minor variations. And so, well, whatever. You can never please those people. But the Fallout series itself, one of the things I hate to say, though, even though I think the core story in Fallout 3 is stronger, I think that overall Fallout New Vegas is the superior game. I really do think that.
I agree.
At the time when Fallout New Vegas came out, nobody agreed. although I was one of the diehards saying, no, wait a minute, this is really good. Because it got dogged a lot at first. But it is the superior game. I think the core story is less emotional and a little more cerebral. And so it doesn't kind of hit you in the gut, like the relationship with your dad and watching your dad get killed and all that. But, like I said, I just finished Fallout 3, including all the DLCs this summer. And today, I've made it through Fallout New Vegas again. And I've made it all the way to, I finished all but the last boss fight on the last DLC.
Lonesome Road?
No, actually, I already did Lonesome Road.
Oh.
And if you do Lonesome Road first, and then you go and do Dead Money, the Sierra Madre, I always want to call it the Sierra Madre, it's interesting how that works, because in this one, they really interlocked those DLCs. So the story in Honest Hearts, that's one of the DLCs, directly is referred to in the other DLCs. All the DLCs refer to each other and have some interlocking stuff. And in fact, if you explore in, for example, what's that called? The one where the scientists are jars and brains.
Oh, that would be Old World Blues?
If you explore Old World Blues long enough, you will eventually, you know, if you're like me, I just like to wander. You will eventually wander into references to Elijah and a camp. There's a camp in Old World Blues in the Big MT there that Elijah set up, where Elijah left some notes and Elijah's done a bunch of things. It's called Elijah's Camp. Elijah is the central villain in Dead Money.
Well, you shouldn't call it the Big MT.
Sorry, Big Mountain. Sorry, Brain. Please do not lobotomize
me. Actually, it's funny because I never got to explore all of those DLCs, even though I had them.
Mm-hmm.
Because the one thing that I really loved about Fallout 3, which I know was changed because of the DLCs, is once you complete the final mission, you can still go on and do everything else. And I
yes.
presumed that that's what would happen in New Vegas. So I did a lot of different things. And finally, I'm like, okay, I want to see the end of this story. So I started doing that. And then I finished the story, the game ended. And I'm like, what the fuck? And I'm like, I don't want to go back. You know, I'm done with the game. It's I was really angry with it, but it was like, if that's it, that's it. I'm not going to continue playing this game if I can't still explore the game after completing the story.
I think that was why a lot of people did not like New Vegas 2. That offended them. Because I remember that also felt like a punch in the face to me. But, you know, in retrospect, they drew a really epic tale there of the fight between NCR and Caesar's Legion and the various warring tribes and Mr. House and even Yes Man, and they wrote a complete ending for each of those.
Yeah.
Which meant there would be no way they would have the time, or it would be a whole new game to continue on in New Vegas. Because you'd have five different games depending on what the win condition was. I think, though, the mistake was that was a mistake that's more obvious in retrospect, because the fact that you could keep going was still kind of innovative in the game world back then, right? So when they were doing New Vegas, I'm not sure they were convinced that that was the best, you know, that that's what was people what they wanted. I suspect
yeah.
Fallout 4 is going to be that way because that's a common fan complaint. I wanted to keep going. And I did too, but I don't know. Now that I'm nearing completion on New Vegas, I'm appreciating on a whole new level what a work of art it is and how deep and complex and interwoven it is. And they did a magnificent job on it.
I wanted to talk a little bit about some specifics of the Fallout franchise, if you didn't mind, Dean.
Sure, go ahead.
Well, I wanted to first address the father issue, and that while it's obvious with your father in Fallout 3 and that whole story arc, there was actually several representations of the father trope being played out. And not all of it necessarily good, but I think it's worth exploring a few of those and trying to, like, really understand what it means to be a father and how this game really explored that.
Go ahead.
Well, let's save the one with the main protagonist for last, but I'll start off with the first one that you explore after that, after you leave the vault, which is with Billy Creel in Megaton. And his story is a little bit interesting, but he used to be a bodyguard for a caravans, and then apparently he killed some raiders, and there was a little girl there that he decided to adopt as his own daughter and took her to Megaton. Although there's a lot of rumors about that he was actually the person that killed her parents, not the raiders, and the house that he owns, he ended up killing the man who owned it just so he could have it for him and his daughter. But I think with a world like the Wasteland and a close-knit community like Megaton, rumors are bound to happen no matter where you go, so I don't know if we could really take those into consideration. But it's the fact that, you know, he saw that a girl needed a parent and decided to take on the mantle of being a parent and a single father on top of that. But he hasn't ever really felt the need to for her to have a mother, you know. And I think that's really good, because in many cases, when there's a father-only parent, there's always this need of trying to get a good female influence in a daughter's life. However, we often see the opposite with single females. They tend to want to do it alone and don't really want a positive male influence for their male child.
That's a very interesting point. I had forgotten that right there in Megaton, you do see that father and child, well, the man who has adopted a child, which, by the way, is fairly normal behavior for human males. Contrary to popular myth, a lot of men really like children, or they say they don't like children, and then they take a shine to a particular child, and it's all over for them. And I remember when I played it again this time, I still didn't get it. I was waiting to be told what the significance of that pair was, and there was no significance. They were just an adoptive father and his adopted daughter, and that's pretty cool. You also have in that same town, in the same opening story, you have the Sheriff Lucas Sims and his son. Lucas Sims is more or less the self-appointed sheriff, only because nobody else seems to want to do it, and they all seem to kind of like him. But he's a father living alone with his son and acting as sheriff. And in many playthroughs of the game, in fact, most playthroughs of the game I've done, Lucas Sims dies. And after you've done things to play the town, a rather stoic child is who gives you your reward. Which is pretty cutting and deep and dark, and there is a lot of deep darkness there. But, yeah, right there, that first adventure in Megaton, you see it playing there, too. God, maybe we should now ask them to protest Fallout 3 as a patriarchal, oppressive...
Well, I definitely have more examples of a father-son dynamic or a father-child dynamic. And probably a really good one was with Fred Wilkes, who was a single father of a young boy. And this was the one where you had all of these ants going around and the young boy was locked in that special container. And he dies defending his home from fire ants. But he instilled a strong sense of purpose in his son. And he told his son, Brian Wilkes, that if he ever made a mistake, he should apologize 3 times and then decide if he actually meant it. But in another thing I'll say about him real quick is that Fred would also take trips to help stock the entire settlement. So not only was he taking care of his son, he was taking care of his village.
Uh-huh. Now, I suppose if you were on the fringe edge of some thinking, you'd say, oh, you know, in other words, he was a slave. Giving all his resources to others, but that's one of the things that I think is wrong with some analyses in the so-called Red Pearl universe once in a while. No, these are men who are building... It is men who act like that who build civilization, who even make it possible. And I think we all ought to have more respect for that.
It also sounds like he's making the choice to do this. Not that it was put onto him to do it.
Right. Like people shamed him into it. No.
Right.
He did it because he thought that it was the right thing to do.
I think it's a very powerful thing that the man actually feels like this is the right thing to do. And there's not this like wishy-washy, like, yeah, this is the right thing to do. It's like a clear issue for him. It's nothing like, it's like black and white to him.
Well, especially considering the time they live in where everyone is desperate to survive. And he's trying to be a civilized man in a world that almost encourages him to be a murdering, rapist, sycophant.
there's also there's some very negative portrayal of females in Fallout 3 in some of the very small subplots too. There's a subplot where a woman traps a man into marrying her.
Oh yeah.
Which is like, it's funny too. It's played off as comedy, but it's like, what did you actually do there? You brainwashed a man. But there's that, and there's another story of a mother with a wild child. She's a single mother and a drunk, and her son's an obnoxious little brat. What a shock. That's a... and that's the sort of thing you don't see actually in TV and movies anymore. Mm-hmm. I think maybe that's why that sticks up for me, because that's actually a common environment for abuse. It's not the only environment for abuse, of course. I mean, there are bad fathers and all that, but the you never see portrayal of an abusive mom in most media. There's an abusive mom character, a big-time abusive mom character, with the obvious repercussions of what a abusive mom will tend to churn out right there on that boat.
Well, I want to read you something that I found on TV Tropes when I went back through and studied this, and I think you'll appreciate this, Dean, and it deals with the issue of Angela trying to force Diego into marrying her. And it's called Double Standard Rape, Female on Male. A very painful example. One quest has you retrieve 30 Nuka-Cola quantums for Sierra Prochavita, and her neighbor Ronald pays you to retrieve them for him instead, so you can give them to Sierra to try to talk his way into her bed. Giving the bottles gets you negative karma, even though it doesn't get Ronald anywhere with Sierra. However, a quest in Rivet City has you retrieve the Queen Pheromones for Angela Staley, so she can use them to seduce the acolyte named Diego, who has taken a vow of celibacy. This quest gives you positive karma. Got that? Aiding and abetting a sleazeball and making a pass as bad, drugging a novice priest to get him to break his vow of his vows is bueno.
Yeah, although, you know, within the story, we must admit there is a sort of frisson there, in that the girl at least is acting like she has no interest in the guy whatsoever. It really doesn't seem to. Whereas in the marriage story, it's clear that there's feelings there, but he's taking his vows seriously. So, I mean, it's still wrong. I'm just saying there's a cop out there. On the story, which is that no, there really isn't. You know, I just tried too hard, but no, there really is, though. It's a total double standard. Yeah. This one guy was trying to get into a girl's pants, but just by bringing her a present. The other wanted to actually fucking marry him and trick him into it. So yeah, no, I was trying to make my best case, but I can't sustain it.
Well, see, for me, what you did with the Nuka-Cola quantums is not actually that bad of a bad thing, you know?
Mm-mm.
She really wanted these things.
And no, it wasn't.
Like getting a gift to present to a girl to show that you're worthy for her affection. And that's the way I always took it. And it's like, you're helping this guy out so this girl, you know, could possibly raise a family and help rebuild the human race again. Now, right, she now, shows no interest, fine, and she still doesn't want to. And, yeah, maybe it's a little bit like coercion, but isn't that what dating is, period?
Well, and it does seem to be changing, but I do. It does suddenly occur to me, and Fallout is good for this, by the way. Fallout is good about not about leaving a lot of moral ambiguities for you to decide. You have to say that maybe you deserve the negative karma, because any guy who's running around thinking he can bribe his way into a girl is like enabling the worst parts of himself as a man anyway.
True.
You should never be chasing pussy that way. No, pussy's worth it. Worth that.
Well,
really.
In a modern time, but, modern setting, I'd agree with you. In a post-apocalyptic place where there's just...
Yeah.
Not a whole lot going around anywhere. It's still wrong, but it's a little bit justified.
I can see that. And more to the point, it's not like, just like a lot of things, kids in Fallout Land aren't that believable anyway. In a post-apocalyptic universe, let's get real, what a real post-apocalyptic universe would be, it wouldn't look that much like Fallout Land. There would be no reliable birth control, so most women would be pregnant or nursing most of the time, and we would be back to some very primitive civilization stuff indeed. So, and if you notice in Fallout, children are always completely unkillable. You can't do it. You can shoot right at them. It doesn't... And they're all approximately 9 years old, apparently, to my eye. So I don't know what significance that observation has, but we may sometimes be expecting too much from our fiction, I suppose.
Well, there is one other element that actually Fallout did get sort of right, is that prior to the use of the modern understanding of medicine that we have, there was always a chance for a woman to die during pregnancy.
Of course.
And the character's mother died giving birth to the main character.
No, that's a good point. That's a very good point. And so that actually opens with something very realistic to what a post-apocalyptic universe would look like. Death in childbirth would be a not uncommon thing.
But also that children would be a resource. And I hate to say that about children, but...
No, they absolutely would be.
After the bubonic plague, which I study a lot because of a book I'm writing, children were seen as something of a social status, that having children meant that you had something other people didn't. And within a nuclear wasteland like that, the same thing would also happen. If you managed to have children... you had a resource that other people couldn't get, which would also make sense why people would go around kidnapping children.
And it would also make sense why in that context, boys were generally more valued in that they were seen as bringing more resources to the community. There is a downside to that, of course, historically. Well, this could be coincidence, but I don't think so. Maybe someone will tell me that I'm seeing something that's not there. If you actually look at, there's an interesting facet to the English language. You know, it's an old language and it's been in written form for many centuries, so we've got history. The root word of the root of the word girl, G-I-R-L, used to mean child. It was non-sex specific. Girl was a child. The root of the word boy, literally, was servant. And that certainly flips the feminist narrative on its head, and it gives you pause, and to me shows the ambiguous double edge of being male in a rough, tough universe, because... And I've known people who've come from third world countries where poverty is beyond what we tend to see in our part of the world. Yes, there's power and pride in maleness, in going out and doing and accomplishing things. But you are very much seen as a servant to your family. And if you are not servant to your family, which means not just your mother, of course, but your father and your brothers and all that, but... You are seen like, yes, yay, a boy, someone who will work. And that's a reality in poor countries that we tend not to appreciate, which is probably why we buy the feminist lie so much that males are innately superior. No, people in poor countries don't prefer male children because they view males as inherently superior. They view males as inherently resources.
Well, something to add to that that sort of adds to your point, because I never actually heard that before, but it's like the origins
it's true.
Of, well, I believe you, the origins of the word woman.
And then you realize, well, why is it that woman has like five letters in it, but men only have three? Well, it's because men used to be called weremen, were also being the root word for werewolf. Yep. And men was something everyone was called. Being a man could be male or female. But eventually we took off weremen and just had it as men, but woman maintained their separateness from the word men, but men did not.
That's right, and in fact, this is why there is something wrong with some feminist analysis, or they've got it on its head, which is that what this also innately means is that men surrender and share their identity with women, whereas women get to keep their own distinctness. This, again, does not say men are oppressed per se, but it's an appreciation of there's burdens on maleness that have been carried around for a really long time. And it's probably why some of us at least get upset with feminism. It's just because you just keep turning everything evil. You don't see anything from a male perspective or what was difficult about it. Even when you claim that you do,
yeah,
you get it backwards. You get it backwards.
And in all honesty, with Fallout 3, I think it does a really good shot at portraying people as they might actually be in this time. Same thing with New Vegas, but I feel like Fallout 3 was more about the people themselves and the situation they were in, rather than Fallout New Vegas, which was more about the situation they were in than the people.
You've just put your biggest finger on the storytelling difference. Virtually all the Fallout 3 stories, there's a real strong connection to the emotional lives of the characters, almost invariably. And you hear people's tough stories and you hear their rough stories. There's a lot less of that, and it's a lot more business in New Vegas. And the stories are intricate and interesting, but very few goes into the intimate and the personal.
Right. Because, you know, it's like Benny from New Vegas,
it's
which
just
is played by one
him.
Of my favorite actors. He's just like, hey, Toots, it's just business.
Yeah, exactly. Sorry it didn't go, you know, maybe we could have been friends in a different life. Oh, well, so now I got to kill you.
Well, I think the biggest difference is that with Fallout 3, it is pure post-apocalyptic, or there is no ounce of structure. And with New Vegas, you're starting to see those structures actually forming in some sense.
Oh,
and
that's a good point. Yeah, than the Brotherhood is the only thing that's mm-hmm. structure at all.
And even then, it wasn't that strong of a structure. It was kind of just really just
a big outpost.
Yeah.
Well, I would argue that Rivet City was a bit organized.
It was getting
getting there. Okay, I can agree with that.
If Rivet City had expanded outward mm-hmm. another few generations, maybe it could have been something big, right?
Yeah.
I loved Rivet City. That was one of my favorite parts of Fallout 3. I just loved exploring that place. I don't know why, but something about that part of the core game.
Well you're like me, Dean. I love exploring. In fact, I just went in the water and kept going around the ship just to see if there was any sort of secret or any something.
And then you found something, didn't you? Wasn't that awesome? If there's a quest line, you know, that drives you to that. But I actually found my way into that once by accident. I think the first time I found my way in there by accident, I'm like, what the hell is this? If people don't know, in this place called Rivet City, there's a place underwater you can get into. And
I don't remember. It's been a few years since I've played it, but I remember that I was just always exploring every single place I could. Even if it wasn't on the map, I was trying to explore it. But I just found out that there was a place called Plunger Dungeon or whatever.
What? Okay.
There's a secret location on the map that is not marked in any way. That's okay. Underneath a bridge, and if you go into it, you got a lot of stems and medics and all of that, but there are plungers everywhere.
Oh, really?
Yeah.
Yeah.
Plunger Dungeon.
I think it goes by a different name, but that's just what I call it, Plunger Dungeon.
The community has given that a similar nickname to that because it's just like, we don't understand, like, there's just a shit ton of plungers all over the place.
somebody was bored one day and just decided to put it in there, right? I mean...
Well, actually, I was going to say with Rivet City, I think, I mean, it does connect with the father, but there's a story there that really tugs at your heartstring. It's, and I think this is the hint for Fallout 4 that they had in there. You have a synthetic man in there, an actual android.
Yeah, you do have a synthetic man in there. And they play that one very cool, too. They play that one very cool. Oh, and what was the place he was? The guy chasing the android, what was he from?
The Commonwealth. Consortium,
the Commonwealth.
Yes. Oh, that
Commonwealth
one.
Of Massachusetts?
Oh, yep. Yeah. That, yeah.
Is that speculated?
It's confirmed.
Oh,
it's, yeah.
That's so cool. I just caught that. Okay. Yeah. I just caught that. Yeah, I love that little storyline. And that there again, the wonder of Fallout is how they'll let you go totally morally ambiguous if you want. You can decide to just turn that android in, and the responses will be all perfectly crafted to rationalize why you should. Right? It's just a machine. It's pretending to be human. You should go and kill it. And they, I don't know, it's like they let you just decide what you want to do there.
Mm-hmm. Well, I think the greatest thing is when they do evil, and maybe this is why I like New Vegas a little bit better. When they do evil, evil's not this irrational creature. It is very rational. It has a logical thought process unto itself, which makes it so terrifying.
Yes, it absolutely does, especially because in a post-apocalyptic universe, okay, I'm going to admit it. I am one of those sissies. I think I'm like the majority of people, but maybe I'm not. Whenever I play Fallout, I want to be the good guy.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, I am.
But
it's hard for me to be bad in video games. I always feel guilty for it.
Except you know, there are certain things I'm like, oh, fuck this guy, I'll kill him.
Yeah.
I had no problem killing Benny.
Oh, see, I liked Benny. I didn't want to kill him.
Can I postulate a theory on the idea, like, why we don't want to be evil?
Yeah.
I think it's the fact that we're actually seeing a world that is absolutely torn to pieces, an actual hell zone, and we ourselves want to bring that, like, goodness to the wasteland. I think it's just in our inherent nature, we want to bring something great and give hope to a wasteland that doesn't seem to have any of it at all.
Well, especially because there's only so much killing and whatnot you can do before it's like, well, why am I bothering? But I mean, I wonder, like, I've never actually met a Fallout player who played all the way through on New Vegas, siding with Caesar the whole way.
Hello.
and how did you like that? Right?
Yeah, he made sense, but it's like, yeah, that's not me. I did it just to play through it, and I'm just like, I gotta take a shower afterwards.
You know,
I killed all the major powers in it so I could have control of New Vegas. The only thing that I couldn't get done was that I wanted to have an alliance with the NCR, but I didn't want the NCR in control of New Vegas. But I eventually pissed them off. They're like, fine, you have New Vegas. We'll just leave you alone. I'm like, no, come back.
The one I refused to do so far, but I'm probably going to do it this time, because I'm just about to finish the game
House.
Out. Yeah, I've never sided with House, although from what I understand...
Oh, you're going to love him.
It looks like that's the best ending, probably.
Mm-hmm.
This is what I've told, that it is actually the most positive ending of all if you go ahead and side with House.
I was telling you that beforehand, I remember a couple months ago.
Were you? Oh, yeah. Maybe you were and I'd forgotten, but because I've had a couple of people tell me that. My son told me that, and he and I are both fans of it. Oh, yeah, dads play video games with their sons. Yeah, that happens. But because he's as excited as I am for Fallout 4. You know what it is because I don't even know if I want this on the radio. I have a certain visceral loathing for... please forgive me, but I really don't like Ayn Rand or Atlas Shrugged. I know those are bigger than the Manosphere. I hate that book. I hate that author. And
so
Mr. House, and Mr. House is so obviously an Ayn Rand hero, right? And that just repelled me. Although I looked at it, I was also in a bad place at the time. Mm-hmm. He, in retrospect, he's not that bad. I'm watching him this time. He's not that bad at all. He's callous, but he's really not that bad. He's just
he still
rude.
Has the compassion.
Considering the fact that he
he's
was
just rude.
Able to mm-hmm. predict nuclear war, he was able to create a satellite system to shoot down nuclear warheads over New Vegas, and anything that got through, he was able to shoot down with a laser on top of his building, and like 60 of the 70 warheads that came for New Vegas, he was able to stop.
Uh-huh. But he's just rude and callous and arrogant as fuck all the time. Although, as an old girlfriend, a really smart girlfriend of mine once observed, because I said of myself, well, we were talking about arrogance, and she said, okay, what you just, I made some remark that I said, well, that sounded arrogant, did it? And she said, I don't know what was arrogant about it. It's true, isn't it? And I said, yeah, but it's still arrogant. She pulls out the dictionary and points out the word arrogant for me and says, where does it say in there that if it's true, it's arrogant? Very first part of the definition is unjustified opinion of oneself.
And there you go. Well,
and Mr. House had every reason to be justified mm-hmm. in his opinion of himself, didn't he?
He was alive for 200 years, and he's still super intelligent. Yeah, I think he has a right to be.
He has built an entire city protecting it from nuclear war and built a city out of savages. A technological marvel among savages, no less. I guess if anybody's earned the right to be a dick, it's Mr. House.
Well, you know what? I feel that there's a parallel between Mr. House and the Overseer from Vault 101 and Fallout 3. And as much as we dislike both of these men because they're smug, they're egotistical,
they're also
they
correct.
They know everything.
Level.
They are correct. I mean, the main thing that the person in Vault, the Overseer, did is he basically concluded that they needed to keep the vault closed because the original purpose of the vault was to stay sealed indefinitely and not ever come out. And then an overseer a few before him said, you know what, fuck that, let's open up the vault and interact with the world. But the wasteland was a very dangerous place, and in some ways being trapped inside of a vault is far better than being out in the wasteland. Provided, of course, that your vault is not trying to kill you in some way, which many of them were.
Again, this illustrates, too, the fundamental difference between Fallout New Vegas and Fallout 3, which is that even that story of the vault is all about the people in the vault and what their lives are like, not governmental structural systems and big social systems. They're all very personalized.
You do have a lot of those vaults in New Vegas, too, but I think it's more prominent in Fallout 3.
And that's where they get much more into, the politics of vault life. Hell, there's even a story in Fallout New Vegas of an election.
Mm-hmm.
That was great.
A very grisly election story is in there. And
that was sad. That one was like, oh, God.
I got to get this out there because I haven't mentioned this to anybody else. Again, this is tribute to my nerdery, but also how brilliant I think they are. I just said what I didn't like about House. He is arrogant, and he exudes a pompous arrogance that's so bad it oozes he must be a megalomaniac dictator, right? He keeps giving hints that he's not a good guy, even though he is. But if you play through, you notice that if you betray him, well, he doesn't react very well to it, but if you even play through to kill him, it's very obvious that his own hubris is what killed him in trusting you in the first place.
True.
And so I have gone and killed him, and I didn't feel bad about it at all. The story didn't make me feel mm-hmm. bad about it. It was like, oh, you did this, and as a result, it even shows more things about what an arrogant cocksucker he was. So if you choose to play it that way, the game, like, gives you, like, well, you were right, because he was a dick. And I noticed a reference to Citizen Kane. Have either of you seen Citizen Kane? It's one
yes,
of the best
I
movies
have.
Of all times, and it's about the hubris of a rich man. And if you follow through most endings, he does, you know, he doesn't take over, he doesn't win. In the one where you kill him, he dies of his own hubris. There is a point when you ask him, by the way, why are you interested in the snow globes?
Mm-hmm.
And he says, what? I just am. Moving on. Next question. And the movie of Citizen Kane opens and closes with the wealthy guys with the snow globe that drops on the ground. And even in subsequent interviews, decades later, they asked Orson Welles, what was the snow globe? And he said, I just thought it was a good visual motif. I didn't think it symbolized anything. So they kind of, so you can see House as very much a citizen, you know, of Charles Foster mm-hmm. Kane character if he fails. And he fails in many of the outlooks.
Well, actually, the one thing I was going to say is when you play through with the House ending, he does come off slightly different. Once I played with his route, mm-hmm. he does not want humanity to die. He wants humanity to actually be at peace, and he wants to give humanity another chance. And his hubris and arrogance is there.
Oh, well, the biggest one is he won't even let you, and that's why that was it. That's the big killer, why I always hated him the most. It wasn't just the whole Ayn Rand thing.
Brotherhood of Steel?
You made me kill the Brotherhood of Steel? I mean, I know this vault they're living in, they've got political issues, but... And you won't even let me negotiate, because I tried, and you try, and he's like, no, I didn't tell you I want to negotiate a deal. I want you to destroy their vault. It does do that to you, too. It's like, no, it will let you negotiate. He doesn't care.
Yeah.
And so they really push you not to give him his way. And so that is pure hubris, actually.
Well, now that one I'm 50-50 on, because when I looked it up, they were actually trying to put a way for you to work it out, and it looks like they didn't give you that choice due to time constraints in development. So,
and the point that I was making with the overseer.
Let you run a part where you just.
Mm-hmm.
I don't believe them. they must have been really short, because, at worst, all you could have said is just. Yes, there's an alliance, and then they don't happen to show up, and don't even mention it in the story that they didn't show up. No one will notice.
The point that I was making with the overseer, with Mr. House, is that maybe to really be in control, you have to be an arrogant prick.
Idea
of politics that we have now, where people have to like you in order to be elected to your position, is kind of a flawed system, because you're always only appointing people who are just trying to kiss up to the next ass that they need to, versus a person that's like, look, I know what's best, I have proven myself, I don't care what you think of me, because you're alive because of me.
That's
what we need in leaders.
Let me put it to you that way. That is the constant dichotomy of leadership. It really is, and I've seen it over and over again in my own life. Even when I was working on A Voice for Men, the truth is, Paul Elam's right about one thing, even if he's right about nothing else. He said it many times. For this organization to fit, for a men's organization to succeed, it must have a strong leader. Period. If you're going to run a site for men. One guy has to be the ultimate decider on everything, period. And you don't have to like it.
It
has to do, or it won't work. At the same time that we're still good friends, but he can be a very abrasive fellow and very hard to get along with. He'll own that. It's not a personal insult. And I found the same thing. When I've had to lead a group, sometimes I have to be an asshole just to get what I want. Mm-hmm. And that's actually the responsibility of leadership. You do sometimes have to do the popular thing because it's the right thing. At the same time, some of the worst, most abusive megalomaniacs also think that way.
Yeah.
And so, you know, the person in power, especially the man in power, wherever he has it, has to always weigh that, well, am I the monster I didn't like? Or do I embrace it? Yeah, of course I'm a monster. whatever it is, right? But once you take responsibility, you're always faced with those choices, aren't you?
Yeah.
It's when you don't take responsibility, or when you're, dare I even say it, a hypo agent, and letting other people take responsibility, it's very easy for you to look at somebody and say, you're an asshole. Fuck him, he's an asshole. You may or may not like the current president of the United States. I don't particularly like him, but whatever. I don't want to talk about him. My point is, that guy every day is making calls. And I mean making decisions every day. Someone's asking him something. He cannot go to sleep or take a dump without somebody asking, wanting something from him. And which is one of the reasons I've always said, even if you hate whoever's been elected, try to appreciate the position they're in. Especially because what they get elected in on is rarely what they actually do for a living. I mean, it's like the job, how presidents run for office has nothing to do with how they do, how they act as president. It just doesn't.
Yeah. Well, I think you touched on a very good point with all of that, with how they handle responsibility, on how easy they will blame other people for their own choices. And I think Fallout 3 actually captures that in a small way. If you really analyze it, you realize that this is what's happening, and that is the Republic of Dan, or is it Republic of Dave?
Republic of Dave, yes.
In that scenario, we have a leader that forced himself to be leader, even though he has election, he's the only candidate, he's rewritten history, and, you know, he can do no wrong.
Mm-hmm.
He is a tyrannical dictator with a smile. And, you know, he controls everything. And if anyone says anything different, he's like, either you leave or I'll kill you right now.
He's like, and if you just know that if he happened to be in charge of a country of 10 million people, you know, he would look just exactly like the Kim dynasty does in North Korea.
Or Donald Trump?
Well, from what I understand, Donald Trump didn't come up rich. But the Kim dynasty has been, like, the current guy is the grandson of the guy who took over the country and the communist. So he inherited it. And it turns out in the Republic of Dave, Dave also got it from his father. He just created a pretense of an election so he could say he was president, not king.
Yeah.
He had it set up so only he could be king. That's always the dichotomy of power. It really is. It's, you cannot escape it in any realm. I can't even remember. One of America's founding fathers said something about this, because when they were writing the Constitution, they were constantly looking for areas where they could put brakes on power. And finally, I think it was Madison. It might have been Hamilton. I think it was Hamilton. This sounds like something Hamilton would say. He says, you know, at the end of the day, I'm paraphrasing because I don't have the eloquent 17th century or 1700s of language, okay? But he really did say this pretty pithily in the language. I'll paraphrase it in modernese. At the end of the day, you have to trust. You have to give power, or this, you have to give power, and you have to use it. At the end of the day, you just do. So you can put all the brakes you want in. You have to. Otherwise, it doesn't work. And so you have to accept the arrogance of leadership and the cost of it and the danger of it. And so I did like that little microcosm of that, because we laugh at Dave, but
there's a lot of truth to it.
There really is. There really is.
And I think this would be impossible to tell a story like this or have these themes and tones, fatherhood and these other ones, without a post-apocalyptics like Fallout.
That's true too. You can play with these power dynamics, and again, now I don't. It's during the course of this conversation I've realized it really deeply. Fallout 3, almost every story is a very individualized story, and almost every New Vegas story is directly political and is about power.
It's
who's got it?
Very
who's not
connected? Whereas it's all Fallout about 3 power. Wasn't.
Yeah. Yeah,
but yeah, I agree with you on that one. It was very much about power in New Vegas.
Mm-hmm.
And almost every Fallout 3 story is very intimate and is about family relationships and friendships and or struggle in coming up in poverty or joining a religious cult.
Well, and the Overseer story was also a very intimate story. If you started reading through his logs, one of the main problems he has is he didn't know how to be a leader to the people and how to be a father. And he often had to sacrifice being a father to being a leader, but he really longed for his daughter to see him as a father and not the leader. And it's actually a little bit sad in that sense.
Yeah, and these are parts of the story, too. Some of this is stuff that you have to really be paying attention. Like, there's parts in those in Fallout, and it's a Fallout tradition, but where you can read people's personal logs, and you can read their personal diaries, and you can read notes and letters that they've sent to each other, and you can get through the game without ever bothering to do any of that or read any of that shit, and the game still plays. At a superficial level, but if you want to explore, they've put in there deep stories about the characters or the societies. In the case of New Vegas, it's almost always stories of societies, except for the weird character of Ulysses, who makes no sense to me in New Vegas. And then the Joshua Graham story is pretty intensely personal. I didn't appreciate the. This is New Vegas, and I did not appreciate the Joshua Graham story the first playthrough. I really appreciated it this latest playthrough.
Mm-hmm.
I made sure to go early.
What that is?
Sure. It's called Honest Hearts, and it is the story of the Burned Man. By the way, there's references to the Burned Man in all the other DLCs and the main story, and the Burned Man is one of Caesar's closest legionnaires. Legates. And he severely displeases Caesar. I'm trying to remember what it was.
He failed taking
Right, but he there was something... He failed taking the dam, but he also did something personally crazy.
What had happened is he had chased after the NCR over the bridge. Remember the area where the cons were holding the NCR officers hostage, and it was you find out the story that the legionnaires were trapped there, and they detonated explosives to kill all the legionnaires. It was a huge total insult and failure there.
But I seem to recall there was also something personal about him going berserk or whatever. But in any case, yes, Caesar basically dripped him in pitch, set him on fire, and threw him into the Grand Canyon. And he was presumed dead, but in Honest Hearts, you find out no. He was he first rescued by the Christians? First reference to a real religion,
He was a Christian to begin with, actually. He was a New Canaanite from the beginning.
He was a New Canaanite from the beginning, that's right. So, which was a Mormon. Christian sect. A Mormon sect, okay, right, okay. Specifically Mormon sect. And then he goes back to them, and he winds up in the leadership position with these tribes. One faction or part of the politics is there's a guy who wants to lead everybody peacefully back to New Canaan. Joshua Graham's like, no, we got some killing to do first. But the story of his personal struggle and what he'd gone through, very intense and very powerful. And it, again, is all about the struggle of leadership. And the only Honest Hearts got lost when New Vegas came out, I believe, because it came out late. But it is, in fact, best played early in the game. It's more designed for lower levels. So it doesn't level very well. If you're already up a past level, like a level 30, level 35, you are going to crank through Honest Hearts, and it's not going to feel like much of a struggle. If you play that at around level 15, it will be a struggle, and at least from my perspective, also made you pay attention more because it didn't feel like, oh, this is just so easy. I want to run through this and do it. The story is really deep. I mean, it's a man who had a horrible experience, you know, growing up, and eventually became a great leader, only to fall to the great depths of and nearly die and nearly be destroyed, lives in pain every day, and is struggling again to rebuild civilization, this time trying to be a better man. There's even a point where he's talking about, like, he's talking to you directly about some necessary business. He's talking about how
he's quoting the Bible to you a lot of the times, actually.
Sometimes he is, but he's talking about how I'm trying to change and make myself a better man, and I am committed 100% to being a better man and following a better way and leading these people to a better life. But just understand that if I have to kill you, I will not hesitate to do so any more than if I had to flick a bug. Just know that. And I'm like, whoa, that's that just flies by. And if you're just clicking through the dialogues, there's no, you know, you don't catch the depth of everything that's going on there. That's an intense fucking story.
And I think that couldn't that be said without a man being that main character. I mean, I think you see that with a lot of men. We'll do the most peaceful for as long as possible. We'll be as great and noble as we can, but there's that point where you step over the line, gloves are off, and we won't take shit anymore.
And in his case, it's like, and I won't feel the least bit bad about it. I just won't. I'm going to go into it, but I'm going into some stuff in my own personal struggles right now that's very much like that. That's very much like that. I won't say more, but yeah, Joshua Graham is a great character. And I remember the first time I played it, I was such a wuss that I sided with Daniel, the preacher, who wants the whole nonviolent ending, and I made it happen. And then I realized on this playthrough, no, that's wrong. Joshua is right. These people need to stay here and fight. They do. It will not only be better for the wasteland if they do it, it will be better for them if they do it. You don't just run forever from people whose only mission in life, the only desire is to destroy you. If that's their goal, then you have to fight back.
I agree.
And so there you go. Gamergate, anyone? No, sorry. But
well, we've been talking about positive males for the most part, especially about fathers. There's one that was actually pretty bad. And this was a hidden mission in the game in Fallout 3. There were actually quite a few missions that don't actually activate any sort of quest at all. And what this one was, it was called the Keller family. And you had to find these tapes hidden throughout Fallout 3. And you didn't even necessarily know if you really got them or not until you listened to them. And basically, it was this family that was communicating together, talking about the impending war coming. And one person, one of the family members, was in the National Guard. And he was trying to get his family into one of the vaults, but that failed. But he says, I have a backup plan. I can get into one of a secure bunker for the National Guard station. And so he gave each of his family members a digit to the code to get in. That's why you have to find all of these recordings so you know the digit to get in. And you can't guess it because it won't unlock for you to get to the door until you find those four.
I never ran that side quest. I knew about it, and I just like, I just don't feel like it. So that's interesting. I didn't notice
what,
that about
what ended up happening, because there's a little bit more to this. What ended up happening is you hear about all of this bickering from this family. This family did not get along at all. They all pretty much hated each other. In fact, one member of the family, the son, one of the sons, decided to just die in the nuclear holocaust than to live with his family in a bunker. But anyways, they all got to the National Guard bunker, and you see this when you walk in. It was pretty much deserted. I think the military, like, didn't want anything to do with it, and they left. The person who gave them the code ended up getting arrested for revealing this information to his family. But it was a father, mother, a daughter, and a son that were left in this bunker. But the father kept getting bored, kept getting antsy. So he would knowingly leave the bunker and expose everyone to radiation just to find stuff to bring back. And what ended up happening is he turned into a feral ghoul after a while. And we don't know what happened to the others. We only see their skeletons. But either they died from the radiation or he killed them when he became a ghoul. And it's one of the worst examples of fatherhood that's seen in the game. However, didn't exactly have a very loving family either, so that was a major difference.
Well, I'd like to add, in Honest Hearts, there's an altruistic nature of man. Do you remember the survivalist rifle when you played it?
Yeah, I didn't quite catch what was significant about it, but I got it.
What happened was the body that it's right next to, this is a guy who had survived the war, the bombs dropping. He lost everything, his family. And if you start finding the diary entries, this is a man who has been broken by it, and he starts coming out. He doesn't have the feeling to commit suicide yet, but what happens is he starts seeing people coming into the Honest Hearts takes place, and the first time he starts seeing people there, and he tries to help them, and they can't understand each other. They're all scared, and later on he finds out they are butchered and killed. He goes after these raiders and kills them. And it has a very big distances in information. He finds a wife, he marries her. He has a kid, but the problem is the wife and the child die in childbirth. And he's distraught, and after that he does not want to really interact with anyone else. And what happened is, he sees a bunch of kids in the camp again, in the Honest Hearts area. I'm blanking out on the actual relocation, but what happens is he starts dropping supplies off to them and being their pretty much guardian angel.
Where are you getting all this?
It's on the logs of the body, and they're in a couple caves. Throughout.
Really?
Yeah. Oh yeah, this is one you can easily pass up.
I missed this one.
Oh yeah. And what it was is it really goes down through his heartbreak, and he starts realizing that he doesn't know how to interact anymore, but he wants to protect these kids that are there. And pretty much these are these kids that survive there. They grow into become the clan of the sorrows in that zone.
Oh, my Lord.
And yeah, and that's the reason why with the survivalist rifle, you find that body. He was getting old. He had protected them. There have been raiders coming in, so he would drop them from range. And these kids thought it was some spirit creature defending them, and he didn't want to break their innocence. He wanted to protect them because he always felt that anytime he did something, it would harm them. So he wanted to take a step back so they could grow on their own, but he would guide them from a distance, kind of like a father, where his hands are not exactly touching the kid, directing him 100%, but it's enough to give a father, like what I usually see with fathers, they give a guiding direction. And
show me any video game or anything in any medium where anything like this can be done. That's an incredible story.
Oh yeah.
That's a novel or at least a novella of its own, mm-hmm. right? That's like a 30, 40 minute movie. You could probably make a 90 minute movie out of that. And that's just a little side story that you can easily miss.
Mm-hmm. Oh yeah.
There is nothing. I have to admit, I didn't play GTA V. I've had people try to make the case that it has a similar level of depth. I don't know.
Mm-hmm.
But this is like, there's no other medium you could do this in. You could write a book like this,
mm-hmm.
but it would be incredibly dense and multi-layered, and it would have to be a series of books, which I guess has been done. I don't have mm-hmm. much interest in them because I can't imagine they're that good. Someone can tell me if I'm wrong. Mm-hmm. But there's no medium you can do this in except video games. Straight up. That's an amazing little story. And I thought the Sorrows were a really kind of annoying little uninteresting tribe. I didn't even think there was anything to them.
Oh yeah, that's the thing is, this is why I say there's a lot of personal stuff, individual stuff in New Vegas, but it's always in the context of a larger institution and social group. And the social group usually has a tendency to override the individual, but you see these personal stories popping up, but they're not like as obvious in Fallout 3, because Fallout 3, there's very, for all intents and purposes, no institution to actually obliterate the individual at all. And I think that's what makes it really hard, and a lot of people miss it, because it's like, it's a subtle thing. And it's like, and
new impending war coming. And one person, one of the family members, was in the National Guard. And he was trying to get his family into one of the vaults, but that failed. But he says, I have a backup plan. I can get into one of a secure bunker for the National Guard station. And so he gave each of his family members a digit to the code to get in. That's why you have to find all of these recordings so you know the digit to get in. And you can't guess it because it won't unlock for you to get to the door until you find those four.
I never ran that side quest. I knew about it, and I just, like, I just don't feel like it. So that's interesting. Mm-hmm. I didn't notice
what,
that about
what
it.
What ended up happening, because there's a little bit more to this, what ended up happening is you hear about all of this bickering from this family. This family did not get along at all. They all pretty much hated each other. In fact, one member of the family, the son, one of the sons, decided to just die in the nuclear holocaust than to live with his family in a bunker. But anyways, they all got to the National Guard bunker, and you see this when you walk in. It was pretty much deserted. I think the military, like, didn't want anything to do with it, and they left. The person who gave them the code ended up getting arrested for revealing this information to his family. But it basically, it was a father, mother, a daughter, and a son that were left in this bunker. But the father kept getting bored, kept getting antsy. So he would knowingly leave the bunker and expose everyone to radiation just to find stuff to bring back. And what ended up happening is he turned into a feral ghoul after a while. And we don't know what happened to the others. We only see their skeletons. But either they died from the radiation or he killed them when he became a ghoul. And it's one of the worst examples of fatherhood that's seen in the game. However, they didn't exactly have a very loving family either, so that was a major difference.
Well, I'd like to add, in Honest Hearts, there's an altruistic nature of man. It's the. Do you remember the survivalist rifle when you played it?
Yeah, I didn't quite catch what was significant about it, but I got it.
What happened was the body that it's right next to, this is a guy who had survived the war, the bombs dropping. He lost everything, his family. And if you start finding the audio, not audio logs, the diary entries, this is a man who has been broken by it, and he starts coming out. He can't. He doesn't have the feeling to commit suicide yet. But what happens is he starts seeing people coming into the where the honest hearts takes place, and the first time he starts seeing people there, and he tries to help them, and they can't understand each other. They're all scared, and later on he finds out they are butchered and killed. He goes after these raiders and kills them. And it has a very big distances in audio information. He finds a wife, tries to he marries her. He has a kid, but the problem is the wife and the child die in childbirth. And he's distraught. And after that, he does not want to really interact with anyone else. And what happened is he sees a bunch of kids in the camp again, in the Honest Hearts area. I'm blanking out on the actual relocation, but what happens is he starts dropping supplies off to them and being their pretty much guardian angel.
Where are you getting all this?
What happens is it's on the logs of the body, and they're in a couple caves throughout.
Really?
Yeah. Oh yeah, this is one you can easily pass up.
I missed this one.
Oh yeah, and what it was is it really goes down through his heartbreak, and he starts realizing that he doesn't know how to interact anymore, but he wants to protect these kids that are there, and pretty much these are these kids that survive there. They grow into become the clan of the sorrows in that zone.
Oh my lord.
And yeah, and that's the reason why with the survivalist rifle, you find that body, he was getting old, he had protected them, there have been raiders coming in, so he would drop them from range. And these kids thought it was some spirit creature defending them, and he didn't want to break their innocence, so he wanted to protect them, because he always felt that anytime he did something, it would harm them. So he wanted to take a step back so they could grow on their own, but he would guide them from a distance, kind of like a father, where his hands are not exactly touching the kid, directing him 100%, but it's enough to give a father, like what I usually see with fathers, they give a guiding direction. And
show me any video game or anything in any medium where anything like this can be done. That's an incredible story.
Oh, yeah.
That's a novel, or at least a novella of its own, mm-hmm. right? That's like a 30, 40-minute movie. You could probably make a 90-minute movie out of that. And that's just a little side story that you can easily miss.
Mm-hmm. Oh, yeah.
There is nothing. I have to admit, I didn't play GTA 5. I've had people try to make the case that it has this a similar level of depth. I don't know.
Mm-hmm.
But this is like, there's no other medium you could do this in. You could write a book like this,
mm-hmm.
but it would be incredibly dense and multi-layered, and it would have to be a series of books, which I guess has been done. I don't have mm-hmm. much interest in them because I can't imagine they're that good. Someone can tell me if I'm wrong, mm-hmm. but there's no medium you can do this in except video games, straight up. That's an amazing little story. And I thought the Sorrows were a really kind of annoying little uninteresting tribe. I didn't even think there was anything to them.
This is why I say there's a lot of personal stuff, individual stuff in New Vegas, but it's always in the context of a larger institution and social group. And the social group usually has a tendency to override the individual, but you see these personal stories popping up, but they're not like as obvious in Fallout 3, because Fallout 3, there's very, really, for all intents and purposes, no institution to actually obliterate the individual at all. And I think that's what makes it really hard, and a lot of people miss it, because it's like it's a subtle thing. And it's like in New Vegas, what I love about it is you don't have to see it. They don't make it boo-hoo flashing lights so you see it. They make it, if you run across it, you are going to go, oh my God, I just saw something beautiful.
Or horrible, but still beautiful because it's artistically mm-hmm. beautiful. I got to talk about the artistry here just purely, again, especially because I'm just having this wonderful experience. I've spent the summer playing it. It's an indulgence, but it's what I've done. I'm playing both of these games back-to-back to completion, including all DLCs. And what the hell was I about to say?
Art direction.
Well, yes. Art in multiple levels. But artistically, there's stuff in there that, in fact, if you're too lost in the game, you will miss it. I'm just now finishing up... the DLC of the subplot of the Hotel of the Sierra Madre. Very nearly finished it. And there's these holograms, as you may recall if you've ever played mm-hmm. that. There's holograms are all a big thing. And there is this whole story of a starlet who was made a star at the opening, and she's going to be at the grand opening. And in fact, you have to kind of activate her holographic ghost just to escape. But there's one part where I started getting really just annoyed, and it was pissing me off. You're wandering around, and this hologram of this woman just is constantly walking around, calling a man's name, and like, annoyed with him. And all my brain processed was, I'm sorry, call me a pig if you want, but all my brain processed was, annoying woman complaining, and she won't stop. And that's all I heard, especially because it was repetitious. And she would go bang, 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 like trying to get somebody's attention. And, well, I can't remember the name. Elijah, I think. Blah, 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 blah. And there's a way you can finally find a deactivator. And finally, it hit me what I was listening to. She was locked in right after the nuclear devastation. And she was panicking because she was not going to get out. And she was alone. And she was trapped there on the top floor. And nobody could get to her. She's dying and realizing we're realizing, you know, you stop and you realize, oh, these are some of her last words. She died this way. And you're listening to that played over and over and over again. It's really fucking creepy once you realize what mm-hmm. it is. And then, you find out a little later, she died probably of a drug overdose.
Oh, yeah. She did. It was with all those syringes near her.
I was reading one description of that, like she probably OD'd because she had a drug problem, but she found out she was sick, and that's why she had the drugs, and she probably killed herself with the morphine, with the medic. She probably mm-hmm. overdosed on purpose once she realized she was never getting out of there. She was sealed in, and she was alone. She almost certainly killed herself. and you get the last image leaving of that place is her ghost singing. That's just so... Oh, man. The writing is killer.
Remember her as she wanted you to remember her, and not how she might have been if she allowed herself to die properly.
That's right. That's right. And that's like, this is Hollywood-grade writing. This is...
art.
This is art. Just in the writing. In the writing,
I'll tell
this
you,
is art.
For me, how I saw the art and a lot of this is the world building. Now, I write articles for world building on how to build a better world, and I go into such intricate detail. And the differences between Fallout 3 and Fallout 4 is vastly different when you consider the world building. Now, I'll be kind to Fallout 3 and say, well, you know, they're trying to do something new. They couldn't get everything done. But with Fallout 4, it actually made the society actually made sense. They had entire fields dedicated to farming.
Yeah, she probably overdosed on purpose once she realized she was never getting out of there. She was sealed in, and she was alone. She almost certainly killed herself. And you get the last image leaving of that place is her ghost singing. That's just so... Oh, man. The writing is killer.
As she wanted you to remember her, and not how she might have been if she allowed herself to die properly.
That's right. That's right. And that's like, this is Hollywood-grade writing. This is...
art.
This is art. Just in the writing. In the writing,
I'll tell
this
you,
is art.
For me, how I saw the art, and a lot of this is the world building. Now, I write articles for world building on how to build a better world, and I go into such intricate detail. And the differences between Fallout 3 and Fallout 4 is vastly different when you consider the world building. Now, I'll be kind to Fallout 3 and say, well, you know, they're trying to do something new. They couldn't get everything done. But with Fallout 4, it actually made the society actually made sense. They had entire fields dedicated to farming. Had a currency that was based on water, the NCR out of California. Their entire currency was based on water rather than gold.
That makes sense, but I never noticed that. NCR script is based on water?
Oh, initially, the lore behind it, they started off as gold. The Brotherhood melted it to the ground, and then they were forced to, I think it was, use water.
That's so cool. I did not know that, but okay. Yeah, this is world building, and yeah, New Vegas really, you feel like you understand this world, and it makes sense. There's competing currencies.
Mm-hmm.
There's multiple currencies. There's multiple frames of reference. There's multiple, I liked the intimacy of Fallout 3. I actually do think the core Fallout 3 story without DLCs versus the New Vegas without DLCs, Fallout 3 is superior.
Yeah.
If you just treat the DLCs as a separate entity. And in fact, the Fallout 3 DLCs are all basically completely self-contained. They might as well be different games. Except for the one Broken Steel. All of the DLCs in New Vegas completely interlock. And even the ones that I thought were weak, I see real strength in. Like, from a gameplay perspective, Lonesome Road is actually quite weak. And because it's pretty linear, it's almost like walking down a tunnel and then turning around and walking down another tunnel and then turning around and walking around another tunnel and fight. You know, and that's, you know, it's just, but it all feels very natural. And the fact is that there, the story, I think, is not that strong. At least I don't feel that it is. Ulysses isn't that compelling to me. And his motivations aren't that compelling. He just seems like a psycho. But the visual art direction and what they do in that DLC with the ambient, I was going to say the music, but it's more like the ambient sound. It's incredible what they do with it. It's visually stunning. The uniforms, especially on the masked men, are incredible.
The marked men. Oh, God.
The marked men and the look of the marked men. The look of the way they dress, the way they behave, the background they're against, the weather, the way they play with sound. One of the reasons you do feel like it's a lonesome road is because you can go 10 minutes in that movie and see nothing or nobody. Right? No animals, no monsters to fight. You'll go 10 minutes exploring. And I love how they've even got the Eddie companion.
Mm-hmm.
He's different from the main Eddie because he floats directly behind your head and he's much quieter,
mm-hmm.
which means you go long stretches forgetting that he's there until you turn around and it's like, ah!
Well, actually, here's the thing. He's actually on a better angle where it's harder to even see him.
I know, right? You have to be at the right angle, which means you do feel more lonely all the time. And then you'll have this silence or just this, you know...
Desolation.
This desolate... Yeah, the music is desolate sometimes. It's not scary so much as desolate and so quiet. And all of a sudden, bang! And you're in a life and death fight out of nowhere.
Mm-hmm.
That is just...
Oh, yeah. I mean,
they did with the atmospherics mm-hmm. on that is so great. You can
Which
appreciate it on that level.
An extension of what they did with Fallout 3 in New Vegas, because I've always felt a little lonely in the world. I always felt like I was really by myself exploring this. And even when I met other people or had companions, yeah, I felt a little bit better, but I really felt like I was disconnected from that. And it seems like Lonesome Road said, well, we know it works. Let's make it worse.
Yeah.
And not worse in a bad way, worse in an artistic way.
Well, I think one of the greatest lines from Ulysses was, this is your road. When you come, you'll walk it alone. It is. His voice is perfect for it. It is chilling and just reminding you that, essentially, you walk your own life. Very few times will you have a partner beside you that cares about you. When you go through shit, you in this world, and probably in real life, I would argue, you're doing a lot of things alone.
I know some guys are going to be like, oh, whatever, man. I just want to shoot some shit.
Yeah.
And well, that's
no problem
fine.
With that. I never understood those people, in all honesty.
But you know what? So those guys will not like Lonesome Road as much. Remember when the first time, you know, I encountered it, I thought it was a little weak that way. And then I started deciding, well, what is so great about this? Because people tell me they like it. And then I started to notice it's the atmosphere and it's the that is intense personal. It's not about relationships at all, except your relationship to yourself.
And when you first time see those tunnelers rip apart a Deathclaw.
Oh, yeah. Oh, yeah.
Well, in some ways, it's kind of like Robinson Crusoe, because he spent a great deal of time by himself.
Yeah. Hey, listen, guys, we said we'd go an hour, and we've gone about an hour and a half. I kind of got to go.
Okay.
All right.
But I was honored to be brought on, and I'd love to talk to you more about Red Pill Gaming, but I really do have to go. My headset's dying.
Gotcha.
It's nice meeting you guys.
It was a pleasure.
All right. Have a good evening.
You too.
Well... we didn't get a chance to talk about the main story, and if you don't mind, Schultz, I'd like say a little bit about with the main protagonist's father in Fallout 3.
Because
I really did a study on this before the show. Even though I've played it, I had to refresh myself. And
I wrote my own article on it, and I agree with you. Go for it.
The thing, we have to look kind of at the history of the game before it happened, which you don't get like a direct thing. You have to talk... to a lot of people, you have to read a lot of letters. But what happened is that they're trying to get this Project Purity to work, which they never were able to do. You got soldiers to protect it. There was a lot of time energy wasted on it. But when James, you know, got what's-her-face pregnant and then she died, you know, his first thought was, I've got to protect my child.
Mm-hmm.
And, you know, I don't know how he found out about Vault 101. But he did. He was able to get himself on there before the Overseer closed it for the second time forever. And what I think happened is that he just wanted to keep his son safe. And then once he got on into the vault, he began examining things. And he examined the water purification system and like, well, wait a minute. And probably started finding information about the Gek. And it's like, wait a minute, if I do all of these things, maybe then I can get it to work. However, he didn't leave right away because he wanted to stay with his son. Mm-hmm. But he realized that he couldn't stay with his son forever, and he wanted to give his son a good home and a good relationship with everyone else, so he stayed for 10 years. And I'm not saying that he figured all that stuff out right away. Maybe it took him like 5 or 6 mm-hmm. years to figure that out, but he wanted to stay with his son. But he did have to leave, and he thought if he could just escape, his son would be all right. He didn't anticipate that the overseer would blame his son for his own escape, because he basically breached the protocols of staying sealed in. But, you know, he had a greater duty to the world, mm-hmm. and also to his son. And then he went to Vault 22, I think it was, got trapped in there, and I guess he died trying to get the GEC system.
He got trapped in the lane protocol, which the evil doctor who was in there kind of set up.
Right.
And that was a terrifying notion. And yet again, I think that's the greatest thing about him is the character, the father figure, is that not only was he doing this for, he had this moral responsibility for his, I'm going to say son because I played as a male character, but for his son, but not only for that, but for other people. And I also felt the moment when you finally reconnect with your father, your father sees it as a sense of, let me give this gift to not only you, but to the wasteland to have a better future with the purifying the water.
Yeah. And I think that's a very perfect example of what it means to be a father, that you're going to sacrifice almost everything to give a better life to your children and to the world itself. And that's what it means to be a man, is to really work hard for a noble purpose. But the problem is, in our modern society, and I hate to preach like this, but it's that we've been so stripped away from that we can't be fathers. We've just got to be slaves. This self-sacrifice that we volunteer for is now forced upon us because we've done it for so long that it no longer has the same meaning anymore, and we're now starting to reject that. But in this society, that being forced to be the servant to the world has been taken away, and this man is now doing it for a noble reason, not because he's required to. Mm-hmm. Because in a lot of sense, he left the project when his son was born, and his first priority was to put him in a safe location.
Mm-hmm. Well, that's I mean, that's the biggest thing. It's like, this is kind of what drove me with the red pill perspective with this game, was that you don't see this, especially in modern media, but video games, we get these little glimpses at it. This little glimmer of hope, actually willing to show the human condition in all its facets, good and bad, and not hiding from it. And that's, I think, what makes something like this so great and powerful. And it allows the player, whether they want to actually take it in deeply and go, oh my gosh, there's so much more, or just blow the shit out of everything and try to have fun without thinking about the grander effects of it.
Yeah, I agree with that.
And, I mean, you see that whole whole story plot within Fallout 3 with the father, it goes, I mean, if you really cut out all the middle pieces, it's relatively short, but it is, I think, the right way of pacing it is because you wouldn't easily be able to follow your father. You would be actually meandering around because pretty much you're popping your cherry going out in such a horrible world. You're going to be doing everything to survive, and that still drive to find your father, yes, it's a main story, so you kind of can't get away with it, but it's a kind of like idea that with a strong father-child bond, the child's always going to want to follow their father, always going to help their father, and always want to be taking the knowledge from their father and do better for them and for themselves. Because you see that even after Project Purity, when the father sacrifices himself, you as a character still want to complete it. You still want to go forward and complete your father's project because you know this is a great and noble idea, something that is quintessentially bigger than you as a whole human being.
And I think that your father is the true hero of the story. I mean, yeah, you've done some really awesome things, but it's your father who sacrificed everything for this project to make the world a better place.
Mm-hmm.
And you know what? In talking about this, we're not taking anything away from mothers. mothers have a very important role in raising children. But the thing is that our society looks at it as mothers are the only role in raising a child, and having a father in the pictures is I can't pronounce that word.
Superfluous?
Yes, thank you. That it's not really necessary. And what this game shows is that it is as necessary as having a strong mother. Now, yeah, your character did not have a mother figure, your mother ended up dying, and the only mother figure you may have had was the old woman. But, you know, the thing is that most games kind of pass over the role of the father. Either he was just some sort of drunk or, you know, a nobody or whatever, and that it's your mother that was like the most important aspect in your life. You know, and this game is one of the few games that shows the importance of being a father.
Oh yeah, I mean, it's one of those that that's the other thing is I remember when this game was initially reviewed and it got glowing reviews, and I think it got a little too high. I think they were just happy that it was another Fallout game, but I think they did miss that point, is that why did everyone love it? And I still seriously think that everyone's craving a positive father or male figure, and this game gave it to them, but without making it completely bashed over the head. Like, it was just intrinsically there, and it felt natural. It felt right.
And but at the same time, there were examples of all sorts of fathers in this, mm-hmm. all sorts of mothers. There wasn't necessarily a pandering to a certain idealistic thing. That you had the father that every child wanted to have, but there were enough fathers out there you could identify with one of those as being your father while still having this one father you really wanted.
Mm-hmm. The 1950s dad.
Yeah.
And I mean, that's the other thing, is like the father always takes the 1950s idea and freeze it in time.
Yeah.
And I think that type of story would be impossible with a father figure talking about it, would be impossible not having it wedged in that 1950s-esque motif. Because, I mean, you start looking at it, like, you have that nature that, okay, a father has a duty and a responsibility, but in this sense, it's post-apocalyptic, and he has the ability, and he willingly chooses to follow that path. He's not 100% forced down it, but he can actually openly reject it, but he made the choice, the conscious effort to go, I'm going to do this.
Yeah.
And, I mean, that's the other thing, is like, you look at it like that, you don't usually, even today, men don't really get that option of being a father. It's usually women has complete control. You're either a father or you're not a father. Like, they're the ones who are the gatekeepers at it. And in this type of world, in this type of universe, it actually shows that the father actually should have an option. And you can see the possible long-term ramifications if a father has that option, that there are going to be good fathers that are going to make that choice to take care of their kids because they love them and care for them and want the best for them.
Well, it's actually been shown that children who have had a strong relationship with their father, like a very good, positive one,
mm-hmm.
are more likely to succeed in life.
I think that's just because it's gameplay, but you could even argue that would be probably the reason why you succeeded in the game.
I'm talking about in real life.
No, I mean, I know that, but it's like a lot of these games do take a lot from real life and instill it in the game, and I think that's, I mean, it would, I don't think they would be remiss, it would be a problem for them to actually think like that, because I mean, you really look at it, without a father you have a huge failure rate, drug abuse increases, delinquency, falling out of school. Like, you realize just those stats alone, a father is necessity, period.
Right. And it's not to say that that won't happen if you don't have a mother in mm-hmm. your life, or that a father fulfills a specific role, but when you have a two-parent house, one fulfills a certain role, the other fulfills another role. And it can be switched between the two, but so long as a child has exposure to those two elements, they have a greater chance of success. But the feminists would have us think that a single woman could facilitate both roles and be successful at it, and the statistics state otherwise. You need both a man and a woman to raise a child. Well, no, I won't say that. No, that's bad of me. You need two parents to raise a child. That can be different elements for the child. So two men, two women can raise a child, so long as they're giving that child two different elements. However, I would still argue that the
mother, father,
who is responsible for the child, should have some sort of connection to that child.
Oh, I mean, that's the things like when you see this. I mean, I'm glad that there was so
I'll
much.
I'll be right back.
Okay.
But go ahead, keep talking.
I was very glad when they came up with this game with all those aspects of the father figure, all the different permutations, and actually having females and mothers having their own permutation. And in a post-apocalyptic world, it would logically make sense to see this diversity of characters that you're going to have the good, the bad, the average, all mixed in there. And within the post-apocalyptic world, you can kind of get away with that dark atmosphere for having and showing the actual base and most detestable individuals there. And with this whole pulling nature of masculine and feminine being shown and not hiding for the fact that both of them can be equally good and both of them can be equally bad, that pull back and forth, showing everything, showing the interaction of father and mother, father to son and all that stuff, and like seeing how it can go wrong, how it can succeed. And when it succeeds, especially in a environment like Fallout 3 that shows a post-apocalyptic, it shows in such a great light, showing that, yes, this is what we need. This is a hope for humanity that the only reason why we may be able to realize this stuff is seeing it simply through it, when all shit hits the fan, that may be our only reason, ability to see what is so great about the father figure and the mother figure and how and when they work together properly.
So I do need to get going, but okay. So I think we need to go ahead
wrap
and close
it up. Yeah.
This. But I want to give a final statement to this, that, you know, Bethesda does some great works when they actually try. And I think the Fallout series is indication of what it looks like when they really try. I mean, I know technically New Vegas was done by Obsidian, but compared to their Elder Scrolls series, which I always felt like were a little bit incomplete games, but even then, they still did an amazing job with Oblivion and Skyrim. So when these are great games that allow you to really see a lot of different things from different perspectives, and playing one game is not enough. And you got to get all the DLCs. You got to get every single one. And it really helps us explore what humanity is. And that's why I love the artistic stylings of Bethesda. That I always feel like I'm going to get some death. And believe me, I do. That just, you know, enhances my understanding of the world just that much more.
Okay, we will end on that. Thank you, people, for listening. We had a great time with Dean Esme and Mad Cat. Thank you for listening, and goodbye, everyone.